business, Andrew Shironov. Thank you very much. It looks much more serious than I expected. I am indeed Andrew Shironov, the rector of Skolkovo Moscow School of Business, and I'm going to be the supervisor of the first plenary session of our conference, which is called The Cities and Territories of Tomorrow, Tools for Positive Change. I would like to introduce the participants of the first plenary. The first plenary has a name. It's called A City for the People, New Standards for Public Spaces. So we are going to hear today the ideas of Andrew Revkov, Deputy Governor of the first Deputy Chairman of the Government of the Voronezh Region, Alexander Gusev, head of the city district of Voronezh, Oleg Shapiro, a partner of the Wow House, an architectural bureau, Ekaterina Maleva, project manager at construction bureau Strelka, Oskar Saifuddinov, art director, Evolution Creative Agency in Kazan. Also, Marina Rakova, head of the Architecture and Urban Planning Department of the Voronezh Region, Michael Osiewski, vice president of VTB Bank, and Sir Jorn Schiemann, representing the Dutch Architectural Bureau, Schiemann Weyers Architects. There are also going to be a number of experts. I'm not going to introduce all of them, but we are going to hear them talk as well. So a couple of words about what we are going to be doing today and what the history is. This year, Voronezh has become the second million-plus city to host an urban conference on the cities and territories of tomorrow, Tools for Positive Change. 3 weeks ago, a similar forum took place in Rostov. And traditionally, we organize 5 of such forums per year. And the 6th one is held in Moscow, which is the Moscow Urban International Forum. So after Voronezh, we are going to Tumen, Perm, and Krasnoyarsk. The topics which are going to be discussed at all of these conferences, which have been held for 3 years, and 5 cities host these forums. So the topic that we are going to be discussing mainly is improving the quality of the city environment, modernizing the city infrastructure, and intensifying the territorial development, transferring to the concept of the compact city. We have been living for a long time in a rather different model, but it turns out that there are a lot of arguments, including economic ones, which speak in favor of transferring to another model. This year, we are trying to view these problems through the prism of recession, the economic crisis. So the participants of the forums every time try to look for solutions and understand that you can't stop the development even in the period of crisis. On the contrary, this becomes even more important because we are now in a situation of an attempt to move from the raw material economy to the new economy where the role of the human capital is significantly larger, and improving the quality of the urban environment is a prerequisite for that, because otherwise the life of the city becomes significantly worse. Also, it's clear that there is a crisis of financial resources, and this is clear today especially. So increasing the effectiveness and efficiency in all the meanings of the word is a key element here. I must say that similar conferences are organized by the operator that's called CitySphere. which is a branch of the Moscow Urban Forum, supported by the Skolkovo Moscow Business School, which I represent, the program directors of the conference is KB Strelcom, and the strategic partner for all the 3 years has been Bank of Moscow, and it's the VTB Group, for which I'm very grateful to Michael Wasiewski, who is present here today. We are going to have 3 sessions today, and we are just starting the first one now. After the first plenary, there will be the next one, which is called Architectural Policy, How to Build High-Quality Residential Complexes, the questions of the modern urban environment. And the third panel discussion is going to be on the Voronezh metropolitan area, a consistent development strategy. So now we are moving closer to our agenda. I already said that we are going to discuss the topic, A City for the People, New Standards for Public Spaces. And this topic, fortunately, has become very popular in Russia. This is the transformation of parks, embankments. It's a topic that's close to Voronezh, and we're going to hear about it today. And we are going to hear about the new experience, including both Russian and international, because there is a high demand from the local people for these elements of public space. As I have already mentioned, we are moving today towards an economy where the human capital and their cost and the desire to keep in this city are key. It is the person that makes the decision whether to live in the city or not. And the qualities of this person as an employee, as a person creating the demand for goods and services. And the higher their expectations, the harder it is to keep them, but the higher their contribution is to the city economy. This topic was, of course, discussed in the Soviet Union, and we had something to be proud of in terms of parks and squares. And in many cities, unfortunately, later they went into disrepair, but a lot of towns and cities especially pay a lot of attention to this sphere and compensate the lack of investment into these objects. So I know that in Voronezh there are specific examples with parks and specific examples with embankments which demonstrate this tendency to move forward. As for the interesting experience in Russia, of course this is the experience in Moscow of the Crimean embankment and the Gorky Park, the positive results that everybody knows about. But there are interesting and beautiful projects also in terms of the economic organization is the embankment in Rostov, Samara, Vladikavkaz, Tumen, which has, by the way, made a very beautiful embankment, which has become a landmark in the city. A lot of important projects on modernizing parks, both attracting the private capital, have been implemented in a number of cities. In Voronezh, these are the park, the Ali Parsa Park, the Literary Square. All of them have their own destiny and path. Some of them more expensive, more successful, some of them less, and all in different stages now. We are going to hear about it today. Before I give the floor to the first presenter, I'm going to mention the questions which I would like us to discuss today. What is the modern public space today? What are the practices of modernizing squares and parks and embankments and streets could be relevant for Voronezh? And whether Voronezh needs a unified concept of developing public spaces, what the situation is there, how to combine the commercial and non-commercial elements, here and what positive and negative lessons Voronezh has already learned in this area, and how to consider the opinion of the local people when we modernize public spaces. My main task today is to make the session interesting, so I call for all my colleagues to try to make everybody interested and get useful information from today. I would like to give the floor to Andrew Revkov, Deputy Governor, First Deputy Chairman of the Government of the Voronezh Region. Hello, everybody.
I would like.
Let us discuss a very interesting topic today. So the topic today is a city for the people, new standards for public spaces. And this topic is global, and it's quite specific on the other hand, because the city is a public space. It's a complex space, and the whole world that we live in is indeed the public space, and there is no arguing with that. So if we talk about the future of our city and the public space, we must mention a few important moments. I'd like to give some statistics. Today, over 50% of the people in the world live in cities, and this tendency is growing. In some cities, over 90% live in cities. Unfortunately for the villages, and fortunately for the cities, this tendency goes on. And this is also true for our country, because we are a very urbanized society currently. As far as I understand, over 60% of the people in Russia live in cities and towns. Also, one more thing I forgot to mention. In China, for example, the country with the biggest population, there are 122 million plus cities. This is what I remember from the open sources, and there are four cities with 20 plus million. In Russia, there are 13.
15. In these four cities in China, where the population is over 20 million people, which is comparable to the population of Moscow, there are only about 80 million Chinese people. What is it? It says that people want to live in the cities. This is the my first conclusion. And my second conclusion is that people don't wouldn't like to live in two big cities with the populations of the population over 40 million people. People would like to live in the cities with the population of 1 million people, and perhaps some more thousand people. One foreign resource says that the optimal population is 400,000 people. Today, there is a very important strategy in Russia to make the country positive for living in the cities with the population of 1 million people, and how to make the life better on the level of comfortable perspectives for people, as it is said in our heading. I think that we've got to talk today about the aspect of the future development of our city. I think that when we are in such a difficult economic situation, we've got to think over the situation with the city. We've got used that. We've got used that the main activity for the companies is housing development. I think that, and the world practice helps us. There are some more investment ideas that give us the possibility to improve the areas. Today there is a tendency for new housing development. We are not talking about the other spaces. There are cities that need some urban planning development, like Voronezh, and we are on our way of urban development. There is a number of questions, like how the urban transport will change in the future. And it's going to be a new modernized transport. This is a kind of an area for investment for large companies that are functioning now in the territory of Voronezh, so that we've got to make funds not only to the housing investment. The other concept is the concept of clever spaces. These are technical resources that are working for human welfare, to make the people's life comfortable and secure. It is for the society in general. I think that we've got to think how our city can be can use these technologies in a few years. There are some ideas, and they've got to be discussed, and we've already started discussing it openly. Another moment, very important moment, is that our city as a territory perhaps I say it in a bit different way, a beautiful reconstructed city. I've been to Hungary recently, and I noted that in Budapest the most part of old buildings has been reconstructed due to the mechanisms of funding, and there is lots of budget given to the reconstruction of the panel buildings that have already been built. They've changed the roofs, and they improved the courtyard territory. They've made it better, and it's very precious in the property market. And the residents take part in this process, again with the banks and with the government, to make the city better and more beautiful. It's a very important moment. It's a large area for business, and when we don't need to build new housing, we've got to improve the old buildings' conditions, and to make the conditions good for all the participants of the development. Can I ask you one question? It's a very interesting question about the housing. It's very interesting from the point of view of a compact city. In many cities, it's quite impossible to build new buildings. We understand that it's often a dangerous way. So to come back to public spaces, you as a person who is working in economy, are you ready to look at this process as at an investment process, so that this process will be profitable, or you are thinking about it as a social obligation that has to be realized and that is not modernized from the point of view of given the budget? Is there any experience as a result of public areas development? Are there any new sources of budget, new working places? I believe in the fact that business can work when it's profitable for businessmen. And I believe that the city, considering the ideas that I've just mentioned, it is the territory which should have the conditions for new forms of business that have that and for creation of new public areas for us. Today, a large number of people work on and the authorities of the cities work on the reconstruction and rebuilding of the large parks like Ali Parusa and Dinamo Park. I don't like to talk about it now because my colleagues are going to mention it a bit later. But of course, there will be some successful projects in the future on this topic, and they are planned to be realized in the nearest future. And these projects concern new public areas, and they will help to make the city comfortable for people, for all of us. Since I've come to Voronezh just recently, I believe, as me as a person with a family, I think that the conditions for the business should be understandable for businessmen. And it should be development as a complex tasks for those economical effects that we would like to achieve. And of course, we would like to make the city comfortable for residents with families, with children. Because if we develop the city typical space, concrete space, we wouldn't get anything comfortable, anything useful, and we'll get the volumes of buildings that are not useful for anybody, and it will be inconvenient, it won't be beautiful, and we need public opinion to solve these problems.
Thank you very much. And we are moving on to the presentation of the head of the city district, Alexander Gusev. Hello, dear colleagues. We are glad to welcome you here in Voronezh today. Thank you for choosing our city as a venue for your conference. I'd like to start my talk today with a topic which is pleasant to discuss, but maybe not completely relevant. It's the day of the city administration today, and I would like to say that it's a special day today, so if I speak for too long, then please forgive me. But I'm gonna take breaks every an hour and a half, I promise. So the purpose of my talk today is to show that Voronezh and the residents of Voronezh understand the need to develop the public spaces, and we are trying to do it in a systematic way. While solving these problems, we set up very high standards for ourselves, and we try to solve them in a variety of ways. And of course, I would like to ask the experts that are present here today to help us with choosing the right solutions that would help us to avoid the possible mistakes. So a few statistics about the city. 1,030,000 people live here. The area of the green areas, including the areas of the forest fund, are over 20,000 hectares. So if we count, then it means that per resident there are 200 square meters of the green areas. It's a good number, A lot of cities don't have that in the world, but we can understand that only 870 hectares are real public spaces, and not all of them are modernized. And so the residents basically use only 9 square meters of the green areas per resident, so which doesn't correspond to the norms. So the task of improving that situation is one of the primary ones for us. I'm going to use the examples to show the aims that we have, which I have already mentioned, using the examples of specific objects. One of the first projects is the Ali Parusa Park. We used all the approaches that I mentioned, and we got a very good park for parents with children. And it is also due to the fact that one of the children's hospitals is nearby, so the parents with children can use this park when they come there. It turned out to be very good, a very good object, and the citizens appreciated that. And it was the one to start our work on upgrading the existing parks and squares and developing new territories. The second important project, maybe the most important one for us today, is modernizing the central Voronezh Park, ex-Dynamo Park, Dynamo. And here we are using a step-by-step approach with 3 steps. Actually, coming back to the Ali Parusa Park, we only use the budgetary money, the funds, only using our own money without any private investments. Have you tried to look for private investments? Why did you make such a decision? We never planned to develop the commercial element of this park. A group of children and young parents were at the heart of it. And we have some food sold there, but not much else. And we are not planning to change the status of this park. The Dynamo Park, I'm going to repeat, it's our main project. There are 3 steps. The first step is the recreation zone, which includes 2 key elements. A big central part where children will play with modern equipment, with modern swings and other things. The other key moment, creating the so-called green theater in the park. It's an interesting project with 2,000 seats and an opportunity to use various stage equipment and to stage different performances, including theatrical and dance shows. And various serious performances like opera singers and others. We are now completing the project and we plan to open it during the Platonov Festival of Arts in June. And we hope it's going to be a good present for the residents of the city. The other 2 steps, the second and the third, include creating the area for active recreation, an area for sports, and a commercial element as well. We plan to attract private investments for construction, and then to maintain the territory of the park. The concept has already been developed, and we hope that next year we're going to start implementing it and find a counter agent, investors. And I'd like to ask potential investors present today to join us. The next thing, the projects which are going to be implemented soon. First, the literary park. We plan to change the name in the future to Marshak Park in honor of a famous writer living who lived here. It's for the children who need to be encouraged to read more. It's located conveniently on the area next to the Palace of Children and Youth, and we plan it to belong to this palace. So we plan to include a variety of areas, first where you would be able to read, and also a stage where children would be able to perform. The children who attend different clubs at the Palace for Children and Youth. The head of this establishment supports us, and he's going to assist every step of the way. In order to implement the project, we plan to use our own funds without a serious commercial element in this project, although, of course, we would provide some food stalls. An important project for us that is going to be implemented soon. It's the Orleonic Park. It's in the very center of the city. It's an important, significant place. And it was the first one to be reconstructed after the war. And now we are planning to modernize it into a six-area park. I'm just going to mention the principles we are going to apply for this project. We plan to attract private investments for construction and the maintenance of the park through concession mechanisms. And here I would like to listen to the experts' opinion, because we have seen some problems, some contradictions in the architectural community and among the citizens. And we are now discussing the project, and we haven't made the final decision yet, although we are planning to make it this year and start the project. So this is about the development of the park. I think it's going to work out well. We talk with the citizens about what we can change. Apart from the green zones, the parks and squares, we also develop the linear spaces, the pedestrian streets, Karl Marx Street, which where we built new significant objects with Marshak's monument and the reconstructed building of the theater. So there are street stalls where pictures, paintings, and books are sold. And developing this space together with private investors, we plan to create another pedestrian boulevard, which would start here and finish at the Marriott Hotel. The project is now being considered, and I hope that all the opportunities of private investors are going to be used here. Another important project of developing the Olympic Park. I'm not going to talk about it in detail, just in brief. We call it the large ecological path with a number of pedestrian paths and skiing paths and cycle lanes in a very beautiful area. I would like to particularly mention the partnership between the municipality and the state. The objects belong to the municipality, and we plan to develop our collaboration in the future to develop the municipal objects on this territory. It's a very important issue because very often the contradictions appear. Indeed, in Rostov, we have seen a similar project that where the collaboration between the three levels of power is being done. It's about the airport construction, and the old airport turns out to be in the middle of the city. So there are three forms of ownership: the federal, the regional, and the municipal. So often there is no legal basis which would allow for investments into the objects belonging to the different levels of the budget. And we managed to be able to solve this problem. So the projects which are planned to be implemented, the most important territory we think in terms of developing public spaces is the embankment of the reservoir. It's in the very center of the city. Few cities have that worldwide. And we would really like not to make any mistake about building the concept and implementing it in the future. The Peter embankment, which is nearby, near the city center. There are a lot of commercial objects here. You can see it on the slide. Various buildings and constructions, but all of them are going to be located on the newly bought land. So we plan to deepen the bottom, the reservoir, and the embankment would stay a public space. There will be no constructions. It will be the green area. There will be a sports area and area for recreation and entertainment. So there's a multi-sided project. We'd like to invite the businessmen to participate and the government of the Voronezh region, the administration. Most of the new land is going to be privately owned, some owned by the region, and some land will be municipal. So there are three sides to this collaboration, and we are looking for partners who would offer the right concept to us, because we can't afford to make a mistake about this territory. We can't make it too commercial or make other mistakes. So we are not going to hurry. It requires a lot of funds, a very significant amount of money, so we need to be responsible about the concept. And the mirror image. The left bank. I can't find my slide, but anyway, this is the other side of the reservoir. We have actually developed a concept already. There will be a temple and recreation area. We know the future investors, and we're going to attract the funds from the federal budget to develop the area for the sports. And there is an understanding of how to finance the temple. So next year, this territory is going to be developed. So if you could listen to two more things I have to say. So major projects are seen to everyone, but we can't forget about the need to develop the existing territories, the local objects. So 3 to 4 objects per year we develop, we make annually. And another thing, we are not going to compromise on the block construction. We are not going to change the norms for recreational zones and for the green areas. We can discuss the norms about the density, the height of the buildings, but as far as the green areas and recreation areas are concerned, we can't afford any compromises. This is what we have to do, and the developers have to do. One more thing. While constructing large important objects, we must understand that they must fit well into the general plan of the territory. An example I'd like to mention is the development of the Peter embankment, Petrovskaya. We understand that it's our shame that there is a very old-fashioned area. We have decided finally that we can't afford to have high-rise buildings, that it has to be low-rise, and we need to build low-rise buildings and no high-rise buildings here whatsoever. I'm sorry, I have to remind you about the time limit. Yes, thank you for your attention. I'd like to ask you a question.
There are several aspects that deal with the public spaces and economy. We've mentioned one already. It's the interest of private investors to take part in the improving of public spaces, parks, embankments, and many other objects. There is another very important topic that deals with public spaces. This is do the authorities think about the investments in parks, in embankments? Do you see any changes in the cost of the objects that are in this land that are actually the subject of taxes? Do you see any interest of participants? Have you ever seen any participants who refused to take part in such projects? Are there additional objects of taxation? So what's the situation in Voronezh? So from the point of view with the relationship between the developers, a very good example is Dynamo Park. We've decided to make it a specially protected zone, and we didn't allow to build any buildings there. It starts in the center of the city, and it is connected with the North District, where housing is developing quite quickly. And we require the building of engineering communications that should have been built. It's quite a large project, and for example, objects. The cost of the object can be about 600 million rubles. So the topic of public developers, participants in the development of public areas and social infrastructures, and as for the questions of investments, this question is hasn't still been decided. So what are the possible solutions in the small towns? It's quite difficult to implement such kind of projects. We are moving on, and our next message will be delivered by Oleg Shapira, a partner at Bauhaus, an architectural bureau. Good afternoon, dear colleagues. I'm going to talk about public spaces. And I'll talk about the objects that have been done in our city. It should be mentioned that public areas in it's a very relevant topic nowadays. And what are the criteria of a successful public areas? What can be considered as a successful public areas? There were a number of discussions carried out. And the possible the solutions are that the ability to attract people via the buildings have just been reconstructed. It's one of the consistent of successful projects. I'm showing the part of. The city area. It used to be Vorobyovy Gory and Gorky Park and Museum Park. I'm going to provide a number of examples. First of all, large public areas are very important objects in our city. As the city influences the infrastructure, so the infrastructure influences the city. When we got down to the reconstruction of Gorky Park, we should take into account that it has become a symbolic area. All the people were there. This is why there is a number of some old places there. Oh, and what happened to this Gorky Park, as to many other parks in other cities that have that were in decay? There was nothing inside. It was like a dried pitch, as far as I understand. So, if we talk about the reconstruction as a city therapy, we should understand that there was lack in functionality. Or what is the reason? The reason is, here is the Gorky Park, and the red lines show the areas which have been reconstructed. People go there, and there are many amusement attractions there. We can't close it. We can't create a master plan and then start to implement this project in 2 years. Only a year, the plan has been developed only a year ago, and we had to implement it in the process. We used the methods of some sustainable functions. There have been some sustainable functions in this park. Gorky Park, it's on the left, so the picture on the left shows it in the past and now the modern picture. In the past, it was the area for swimming, and there was now there is a kind of a beach. You can't swim there, but you can just stay there. So if the object has successfully been implemented, it continues its living. There used to be the Green Theater in Gorky Park, and now it was Stas Namin Park. And we've decided to build a summer theater, and there are some movies that are broadcast there. We haven't thought about it before, but now it's functioning all the day. The next object on the top is Vorobyovy Mountains. It's a natural protection object. There were a number of restricted areas with quite a lot of space. There were some public buildings, some cycling areas. What the object that has been reconstructed first was the pond. And actually, these were the people who made the builders just finish it more quickly. We live in the north country. Even Voronezh is located in the north of the region. And people have got to organize their free time somehow in cold times. And on the streets, people used to walk around the streets. And we decided to create a skating rink. It's an artificial skating rink, and it passes through all the passes and under the 300-meter bridge, where all the people who are reluctant to take part in this entertainment event, they can have a look at other people. There is light there, there is music there. Of course, well, it is the advanced ice skating rink. There is cafe there. You can lend the ice skaters. It used to be the largest in Europe, and now the largest skating rink in Europe is VDNH ice skating rink. There are so many smiling, active people there, and well, it's quite difficult to see so many sober people there. There isn't any alcohol sold there. It's another impression. And it's another impression for everybody to understand what the atmosphere is like there. We don't sell alcohol, but the entertainment is existing and there is lots of fun. What happened there? There used to be a Stalinist park, and now it's a new positive symbol of Moscow. In 3 months, when the reconstruction was being implemented, the public has changed completely. Another object is Krimskaya embankment. We can see in the picture that down the picture there is a Gorky Park. We decided that there should be something to be done there. The main problem was that, as we can see on the slide on the left, there was a Gorky Park and the road, and on the right there was a dead end. And there was a bridge that led to one large street. So there were a number of contradictions about the areas. There should be some transition areas for people to move from one space to another in Moscow. Since there were no any bridges available, they decided to build some territories for it. There was quite a large budget investment in it. The main idea was to create a kind of a landscape attraction there, so that people's impression would change everywhere, so they can see the hills and then some promenade areas, then they can see the central square, and perhaps some vernissage, and then the Gorky Park itself. We've created the space, taking the public into consideration that in the morning there will be elderly people with the children and in the evening adults. And we've thought about the pastime in this park in winter. So there is a calm, secluded place shown in the picture. When you move along the embankment, you feel that there is the water nearby. And it was quite interesting to go up the hill. We are walking along this embankment, and one of the places to stay is a cafe. So these are the hills, and there was a little mistake with them. We asked an Italian designer, and we decided to make the path that look like waves, but it was a bit inconvenient.
One of the objects that we can see here, on the one hand you could go up, you can go down, and on the other side there was supposed to be a bridge. The bridge didn't happen, but it's being used like it is. So now there is a tiny hill, so in winter you can go down the hill. But due to recession they don't change it for the summer anymore. Then the green area. So we made a local park. There are the fountains with a huge amount of water and lights. It can spread the water around and you can project images onto it. And there are lots of kids running around. You could potentially turn it off and then you get a huge open space and organize a fair. So you could organize the city events here. So it saves the place from monotony. I don't like these events myself, but the people do come here. So what happened here was the change from the negative perception to the positive perception of a European space. So we like the final. So the dark passage is the ring road. So you can see the lights. Unfortunately, we had some problems, but finally this space is being used for some concerts. I often come to these places myself. The easiest solution to just open the passage under the Crimea Bridge, which would cost very, very little, and allow the traffic in one other place. So it created 17 kilometers of the so an opportunity for cars to move along the embankment. So I'm addressing the city authorities here. What you need is the brain, not the money. You can open up huge spaces which would generate the people traffic and the finances. So you can just look and create an open space, and the whole city benefits. It breathes. And there is such an interesting space. Indeed, we need to get rid of the inertia of thinking. Because when we addressed the transport department to calculate the change in traffic, we took away the cars from the Crimea embankment. The changes was not 0.01%, which makes no sense. Another thing we can see is the Chorne Ozero, literally Black Lake Park in Kazan. This is the only square in the center of Kazan, which fell into disrepair. Although there is a university and the theater and the ministry nearby, and you can see the Kremlin, but yeah, that's because they don't think about themselves, they think about the people most of the time. Yes, so there was no interest in this park for some reason. It's an architectural monument which frightens the people away. I must say that the territory can be saved. So our task was to change it for the people, for the residents, but also preserve its image. So you can see on the slide, it's not as it was and as it is, but rather as it was and as it will be. The lake moves down for some reason all the time, so it stopped being a lake and turned into something like a swamp. So one strategy is to bring the lake back. We need to restore the objects and build a cafe and a children's center. All of it is being done using private investments. I have to remind you about the time limit. You don't have a celebration today, I hope. So the easy solution here is to it's called the whispering entrance, because you can stand on the one side and you can hear even a whisper on the other side. So our task was to make a park not a myth but a real symbol. The other former lake was turned into an inclined space, like a beach or theater where people can organize events or just lie there, organize picnics with their children. We'll see how it goes. Thank you very much. I would like to give the floor to Ekaterina Maleeva, project manager at KB Strelka. Hello? Is the construction bureau Strelka that I represent? As it became clear from the talk of Oleg, Moscow has organized a lot of work on upgrading the public spaces, and a part of this work is modernizing the streets. As part of this program, we have developed a standard for Moscow, which I'm going to talk about now. Modernizing the public spaces is a trend in the development of large cities of the last 20 years, starting with the year 2000, resulting in a number of important objects like the Republic Square in Paris. But this kind of objects do not shape a complete environment of the city. They bring the streets together. The streets are the most important public spaces in the city where all the residents go through every day. We can't have individual projects for each street, so a lot of cities develop standards of modernization of the streets. They are interdisciplinary documents which regulate not just the safety, hygiene, and accessibility, but also the issues of comfort and the quality of the environment. These standards set clear requirements, but also offer an opportunity for variation. When we developed the standard for modernizing Moscow city streets, we wanted to consider the Moscow local context to solve the local problems. So we started with a complex analysis of the problems of modernizing the streets, invited a lot of specialists, both international and Russian, in a number of areas, starting with transport planning and ending with city lighting and climatic comfort. Then we analyzed the streets of Moscow, all of them, over 3,500 really, from the point of view of the geometry and how much space there is for modernization and the priority of their usage, what they are, a transport artery or a public space where people spend time. As a result of this analysis, it turned out that there are 10 types of streets which have similar parameters. These are the most characteristic of Moscow. And this a good classification because only 50 do not fit into it. These are the ones that have a special significance for Moscow and have to be modernized based on individual projects. But those that fit into the classification, we can offer for these streets all sorts of solutions for each type. Based on the structure of Moscow, we can determine three types in the center on the periphery of Moscow. For each type, we made a general image, the profile of the street, where you can see all the features of each type and all the problems that can arise while modernizing the streets. Sorry. Now I'm going to look at the standard, at how the standard works using one type for 10C streets, the radial streets in the center of the city, 22 of them with a high concentration of transport and pedestrians. So studying the problems here, we offer general recommendations for modernizing the streets, like connecting the two parts of the cities more in order to develop street retail, to put pedestrian crossings more often, 50 to 70 meters must be between them. And then based on these recommendations, a question, does that influence the flow of the traffic? What exactly? The number of the pedestrian crossings? Actually, well, we talked with the specialists, the transport specialists. We can afford to do that without influencing the flow of traffic because that introduces some discipline among the drivers, doesn't let them break the speed limit, avoid accidents. So in fact, this doesn't change the traffic flow. Let me continue. Based on the recommendation, we offer two options for planning streets. What kind of functional zones? There might be the transit zones for the pedestrians, terraces of the cafes, placing lighting. And for each of the functional zones, we offer a range of solutions. For example, like the seasonal, organizing the seasonal cafes along the street front. And next slide, please. How to place the short-term recreational areas around the parking places. And there are typical hubs which can be used in the project, altering them a bit depending on the unique requirements. A number of benches and bicycle parkings also need to be included, and we introduce some technical requirements which allow allow us to maintain a high level of quality in the environment. The standard is mainly aimed at two users. One is the person who ordered the standard to determine which streets need to be addressed first and evaluate the quality of work. Then the architect and the planner can solve the problems easily, the problems associated with planning the street, and it's a very convenient thing. So on the whole, the standard allows to increase the quality of the urban environment, to set up a certain level of quality which all the public spaces would maintain, decreasing the terms, the time in which it is done, and decrease the costs in order to regulate the process of modernizing public spaces. Thank you, Kate. A question?
Could you tell us how much important are these solutions are for this city, and can they be applied to other cities like Voronezh? So to what extent can this job can be used in other experiences? When we were developing the typology, we've created a number of methods that can help to define the typology. We can develop the same kind of typology which can solve the problems of Voronezh city. We haven't had any inquiries yet to the other cities, but we would like to give a try and to implement some kind of project in other cities, since the head of our city district is smiling, so that we are going to you to have it. And our next speaker is Oskar Saifuddinov, an art director of Evolution Creative Agency in Kazan, and he is going to talk about another project. So, the first slide. I'm going to talk about the problems of Shamsinur parking zone, about the problems of private developers. I'd like to give a kind of a prehistory. Every man should build a house, so that I bought a land. I decided to build something there, but the area remained undeveloped during the winter. I've spent lots of time on some building forums, and I decided that I've got to leave some reliable buildings, and I've read lots of books, lots of literature, and now I know a lot about the buildings. I can answer any question, and I'm going to build the house in my area in spring. I've come and I did the same kind of thing. All my experience, all my winter experience has disappeared. And a problem turned out, so that I addressed my friends who are builders. So here are the pictures of tired people who were addressed by me. And all of them said that you don't have to build anything there. You've just spoiled 2 million rubles, and you wouldn't build anything useful. So problem number one is connected with climate, geology, and elements. Here, how it used to be, how it all started. It's in Almatinsk city, 250 kilometers from the city where I'm living, where I'm working. So there is a stream there, 1,700 meters in length, with old concrete slabs. So this stream is not used by the boats. So the concrete slabs were put there in the past, and everything was very old. So this is the geographical sketch, an old geographical sketch without any communications. So it was a good place, and I've made a sketch. I've put some paths without any dead ends, without any steps, and I took all the authorities' wishes into account, and the playgrounds were there so that mothers with children could stay there, and everything was rounded by the green space. So I've made the final layout, and I talked it over with the authorities. Then I had to give this layout to the builders, and so that I can forget about it. But the director of my company said that since you've created it, you've got to implement it. So that I went to Almatinsk city, rented a flat, and took the working group of Armenians. 18 Armenians, and we started to implement my project. I've started some construction works from the stream to clean it, to make its banks waterproof. And I haven't changed anything else so far. We've started from the stream. We've did everything quickly with the guys. It was a good job, but on the seventh day, this same situation happened. I saw these people who were just sitting, and they told me that they can't fill this stream with the concrete because they got wet, and there should be another way to clean this stream. So we started to clean it in another way. It was quite difficult to work in such conditions because there was little oxygen there and lots of exhaust gases. We've made a kind of a pit because it was quite difficult to get there. And then the rain started, so that our machine was flooded by this rain. But this rain, it gave us an impact, and everything that has to be cleaned was washed away from the stream. Do you feel yourself like a Heraclitus? Oh, so it was good luck for us, because but for this rain, we wouldn't have managed to clean this stream. We've finished our work, we've made the concrete banks, and we've cleaned the stream bottom. It's now clean. It's really a clean stream with fresh water, with water. And now let's talk about my thoughts about it. 10,300 rubles per square meter was spent. Then I looked at the dimensions of my area. Then I looked how much money do I have, and I realized that that's not for me. So here we come to the next problem concerning money and materials, and money again. The Almetyevsk authorities wanted to have some sporting equipment, lots of sporting equipment, a running course, pedestrian zones, areas for doing yoga, playgrounds. They would like to have lightning all over the area. They introduced me to a guy who is a sportsman who can help me with the sporting equipment because he is fond of workout. So it was quite simple to work with the sporting equipment. It is nothing difficult, but it was difficult to work with the equipment for workout sportsman. All the parameters, they were rejected by this person, so that I decided to go to Kazan and to make everything that you need there. I set out when the guy said that don't make the paint too smooth, otherwise a person can fall down and break his extremities. Okay, I said, and we did everything as he asked. We've made the pull-up bar, and we put the paint in two different ways, with two different kinds of paint. Then the running course. Then there was a problem of the running course, and we couldn't make the rubber surface because of lack in funds. The main point was to make it comfortable and to make it clean, so that it would be convenient for those who would like to use it. So we've come to the solution, and it was quite a good one. Everybody liked it, and it was convenient to walk around because it was clean even after the rain. And then there was another problem connected with the light, ground light. I thought to do such kind of things, to create a line of the lights along the paths. It was quite simple. Here what we got, it was like a miracle. Then I went to Kazan to look for benches, and I made a choice. I found a good benches manufacturer, but it was quite expensive. So I went to the plant again. So this is the picture of amphitheater that is being finished now. Here we brought some black earth. Uh, And here we come to the next problem connected with crime and hooligans. In fact, there were a number of people who said that that it's better not to put benches there, since it may get to some problems. So the explanation was that the area is not a very good for living, but we would like to improve it. For me, the best reward was when I saw parents who say to their who ask their children to say thank you to me. It was a great reward for me. The park has become revitalized, really. And lots of people attend this park. This is the person I know. He works there. And as for the lightning, it was very good. So here are the pictures from Instagram. And this is the real evidence of the improvements. So what I'd like to say that you shouldn't be afraid of any difficulties. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Oscar. We are a little behind the schedule, so we now need to listen to one more short talk by Marina Rakova, head of the Architecture and Urban Planning Department of the UK. So, Marina, could you tell us about how you deal with the public spaces in Voronezh?
Hello, dear colleagues. Andrew, first of all, I'd like to say thanks to you and your team. You choose topics really well that you bring to the regions. And I'm glad to know that Voronezh is not only famous for its monument of the kitten from well-known Russian cartoons, but also for its public spaces. I'm going to say a few short words about our opposition that we have implementing together with the active participants of the market, the architects, the professionals, the citizens. So our priorities, and this is what we heard in many of the talks, the linear public spaces. We need to overcome the thinking where the land legislation is dominant over the city planning and the architectural logic. And so the students and the young people are the most flexible and free from such dogma. So the projects that we have started speak to the fact that these are our priorities. The embankment of the reservoir is probably our biggest and most important territory. So in our city, there is a wide variety of opinions. Some people say nothing is being done to the embankments of the left or right bank. Other people say that it's good that nothing has been spoiled yet. We have prepared these territories, and we have an idea of how this can be done. And it's very important that we can't afford to make a mistake. We are a happy city in this respect. We can start with the easy things, and we talked about this with the young people when we prepared the architectural forum. We thought we could organize an architectural festival, just make a linear pedestrian path. It can be done in a couple of weeks. There are a lot of stories, a lot of thoughts, and a lot of discussions. we are sure that we are not going to make a mistake here, because we have the dialogue, we have the discussions and talks. As far as the standards are concerned, it was an interesting talk about the standards. From my last trip to Moscow, I brought a book on this topic. There is a lot of work to be done, and we are going to talk about it during the second plenary of our forum. Having said the design and the regulations and having started to implement it, we have changed the attitude of both the designers and the people who live and work in the business sphere. There is some counteraction, but the results that we see generally help us to bring the like-minded people together. So it's important to think from the bottom up, and the city definitely needs the standard and contact and dialogue. So this is it in brief. Thank you very much. I'd like to remind you that this is not the last session, and some of the speakers are going to take part in the second and third. Down to Mikhail Osievsky, Deputy President and Chairman of the Management of the Board of VTB Bank. So what is your interest in public spaces caused by? Everybody heard to Oscar, listened to Oscar's presentation with a lot of interest. And I like the money material, money formula, where the materials change, but money stays. So I'd like to say that the cities are becoming more and more important in a country. The domestic product of Tokyo, that 2% of the global one, and this is caused by an increase in the productivity in agriculture. Modern tractors, oh no, with the mayor, I'm sorry. The tractors replace a large number of people who used to work on the same tasks. It's a strange conclusion to make. So it's becoming more and more post-industrial. If we look at the capitalization of the major companies 10 years ago, we see General Electric and Boeing and banks. Today we're going to see Apple, Microsoft, Facebook. And indeed, the for these companies, the main value is the people with the experience that shape the economy. And the people who pay a lot of attention to the centers of education and science and research. For example, Microsoft uses Seattle, one of the centers. It's a very comfortable city, and the authorities pay a lot of attention to it. So the topic that we're discussing today is vital for seeing the cities and territories of tomorrow. The cities change, the economy changes, although it is overinflated with 100 biggest companies accounting for the largest share of the domestic product. So we need to add value to it, add the quality. And the projects that we saw today give an opportunity to develop new kinds of business, the small and medium-sized businesses, which all of us want to support, and we are waiting for that. But what we need is creativity and new people. So seeing the powerful drivers of the future economy in the cities, we support our regional meetings and forums, the Urban Forum in Moscow. And of course, we have our own vested interest in that. We think a lot about how our bank infrastructure should develop and what new approaches can be applied to organizing our production process. Voronezh is one of the largest centers, and hundreds of people work here. Our operational department is located here partly, which serves a third of the country. And the harmonized development of the city is very important for us, as well as an opportunity to attract new qualified specialists who view the quality of the environment as an important factor that would encourage them to stay in Voronezh and not move to Moscow. So we don't want to centralize our assets. We want to leave them in the regions. There is competition among the 13 biggest cities, and we like to look at the cities and what they have to offer. So for me, the biggest example that changed the city is Bilbao, which used to be the metal industry center, and it changed. It changed the life of the place. We have similar examples in our country too, and we'd like to wish every success to our future collaborators. Thank you. So finally, the last speaker for today, last but not least, Jörn Schiemann, the partner at the Architectural Bureau. So how is it important, how this topic important for your country? For me, when I come to a new city, it's not the museums that I pay attention to, it's the streets. And the streets give us the main impression of the city. So what is your experience like of working in public spaces?
Actually, I'm a speaker for the second session, but I was asked to join this session to give a comment on this particular matter. And in my perception, the public space starts right where the private space stops. The moment you step out of your front door, the public space started. So I don't know if I have to give a specific comment on how to modernize parks or streets, but I think that is an essential way of looking at public space. When I do recreational activities, I do it right from my front door. I go jogging from my front door. I take my race bike and go biking. So the whole city, I think the contemporary city dweller takes the whole city more or less as a recreational space or as a park. And so I was also glad that Ekaterina took the topic of street as one of the main topics of public space. And of course, you can talk about all the functional aspects of street, but mainly you should also talk about the interaction between the built environment and the street, and the friction area between facade and public space. So this is a very essential topic, how a street is formed. And I've seen a lot of designs, specific objects that try to modernize the space. But in my perception, it's also very important that parks in general, or the city, is a more or less flexible space to facilitate various public activities, to facilitate social interaction. So what you see in Rotterdam is that you have a lot of pop-up activities on all different scales. A park becomes into a pop podium, and 2 days later it's again this park, or my street changes into a flea market once a month, and for the rest of the time it's just an ordinary street. So I think an object or a specific modernization can give a certain initial effect, but you also should keep in mind the flexible use of public space, and it's designing a park. It's not should not be a kind of personal or architectonic statement, but you should think about the possible activities that can take place. That's mainly what I want to say, I think, about this issue.
Thank you, Joran. Unfortunately, we don't have enough time to go to the questions, but you will continue in the next session.
Thank you so much. I'm sorry if we were not able to give the floor to the experts, to the other experts, but we've really run out of time. I'd like to make two conclusions. So at the level of the city and regional authorities, we have a civilized understanding on the importance of public spaces. Not only as of something that has to be spent money on, but also something that changes our understanding of the city, especially among the residents of the city themselves. This is our target audience. So another thing, you can't really change the city on a large scale in a month or in a half year, but you can make a number of attractive spaces which would transform the perception of the city and make the residents feel that the city is changing in the right direction. And these are the key elements that change the residents' opinion of the city and create the right ideas among the authorities and among the residents. So this is the topic that we have discussed today. Thank you.